yet another episode of our CNS Focus interview series. We have with us today Dr. Rita Banik, a senior educationist and a cancer survivor. She has been mobilizing people and advocating for improving cancer care with single-minded devotion. Rita is the founder president of Race to Reign in Cancer. She has won several awards for her inspiring leadership in mobilizing cancer-affected communities for improving cancer care. These awards include Barclays WIN Award, Notable Network Award from BNI, Mumbai, and DNA Winners in Life Award, to name a few. Rita is indeed a brave and a courageous woman who has battled cancer, and despite her struggles, she is standing up to mobilize people for greater action on improving cancer care. Welcome, Rita. Our respect and salutes to you. Please share your invaluable experience with us now. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Shobha. Outline of my presentation is that I'll tell a brief history about myself. Self-diagnosis, since I was diagnosed twice of cancer, and the emotional stress and all that I went through because of the cancer relapse, and how I decided that I will live with a positive attitude and I will not refrain myself from my work and from cancer awareness that I do for people. Cancer care and prevention, that is mainly for people who have not been diagnosed of cancer. And a bit of some of the symptoms, signs and symptoms of cancer, which I'll show, and there'll be a take-home message, and about our upcoming event. Yeah, next one, please. Next slide, please.
Yes.
So about myself, I was born in Delhi. I did my college from Hindu College, Delhi, and then I went to Moscow for my further studies and to People's Friendship University. So I joined there. I had gone for mathematics, but I switched over to geology. So I did my master's in geology. And then when I came back, I got married and I got one daughter. And in 2006, I was diagnosed of breast cancer. And the whole treatment was done in Delhi, Batra Hospital. And after that, I was quite okay. I was living in Assam. And for 7 years, everything was fine. And then I moved to Gujarat. And in Gujarat in 2012, myself and a friend of mine decided to give presentations for cancer awareness. We started with the presentations and slowly we registered our charitable trust. But in 2013, I got another relapse in the sternum bone. So for which also what happened was in the first time when I had breast cancer, I felt the lump myself. And in 2013, when I went to the doctor, he said, everything with you is fine. There's nothing wrong. You are just worried. And then second time, once again, I went to him. I told him, you must do some scan because there was a kind of a protrusion in my chest and it was getting reddish. So then he sent me for PET scan and it was diagnosed positive for bone cancer. And even now I'm taking medicine for the same the sternum bone, and there's a small spot in the lung also. So after my treatment of breast cancer, after 2 years of that, I got reconstruction surgery done. That is, that using the flap of the body, the reconstruction of the breast was done. And I would like to say that during my chemo days itself, I had started speaking for cancer in public. I was attending the support group meetings, and I never covered my hair. I in fact attended weddings, and I also told others, whoever I met, I used to tell them that why do you use scarf and all that. You should be okay with whatever your looks, the way you look should be fine. Nobody can judge you for your looks. So that's how, I was quite positive during my treatment and even after treatment. It was only after 7 years, long years, when you feel that you are cancer free and suddenly it comes back again. So that gives you a shake. Yeah. Next one. Next slide, please.
Yes, yes. It will take a little time. It takes a little time to load up, Rita.
So for about self-diagnosis, I told you in 2006, I went for biopsy myself. I told one of my friends that there's a lump and we went for the checkups. And same in 2013 when I got this again. So I had to literally force my doctor to do the checkup. Yeah, next. And in 2013, my sister Neeta in Lucknow, she was also diagnosed of breast cancer. And it seems that cancer is still continuing in our family itself, because a couple of persons have been diagnosed. And Neeta, I wonder if you know that she is still, once again, she got a relapse in the same site, same where she had been diagnosed earlier. So she is going through chemotherapy. So, and so it's like both the twin sisters are under treatment, even at now, at present. And I would say that this, the cancer has not taken away our smiles. It has increased, strengthened the bond between us. But it's always very difficult to take the take it that your sister has been diagnosed. I always felt that she is the happy-go-lucky one. She can never have anything. And I was happy for her the way she was. But it's sad. It's very sad to accept the fact that she is undergoing the treatment. Yeah. Next one. So, and this denial was there for me in 2013. When I was diagnosed again, my daughter came, was told, and my husband knew, and I told them that don't tell anyone else at all. And we did not tell anyone. For 1 week, I did not talk to my relatives, my mother, absolutely no one, because I didn't want to tell. But finally, I decided, no, it has to be told to others. And then it's like sharing helps a lot. And when I shared with my sister, it was, again, the shock came back to me that she was diagnosed. And I have made this firm decision that I will not die of cancer. And for that, I am doing yoga these days. I am trying my best for whatever I can. And I also go for special yoga classes for these diseases. And I am taking Ayurvedic medicine along with the allopathic that I am taking. Yeah. So cancer care and prevention, everybody says that, oh, you've got cancer, you should do this, you should do that, you should eat this, you should not eat this. But what I have felt is that once cancer is there in one's body, it's very difficult to completely overcome it with only diet. Maintaining an alkaline diet is important. So for that is important for everybody, not only for the ones who have had cancer. And those who have had, the cells are so strong that it's not easy to stop them from growing, from multiplying fast. So we, once, if I have got cancer, I have to go for medication. You cannot avoid that. But the ones who have not got, they should go for breast self-examination for women regularly. And if there's any lump or anything, they feel any problem anywhere, they should go for a monthly, for a clinical examination. And nowadays it is personalized screening. It's not that every year you have to go for mammography, every year you have to go for pap smear test. If any hospital says that you have to do this, that's wrong. Pap smear test has to be done after marriage, 3 years from marriage or after the first sexual intercourse, and after that, 3 years from then. And if once, twice pap smear test comes okay, then one does not have to go for it. And it's the health of the person who is going for screening tests and the health of the whole family. And it's all about the case history, which decides how much of which treatment should be, which screening test should be done and when. one should not do it every year, especially the radiations and all should not be taken every year. HPV vaccine is good for cervical cancer for young girls and even till the age of 30s. Girls should go for that. Yeah. And it's very commonly said that early detection saves lives. Still, people do not go for regular checkups. People are so scared. When you go and give a health presentation anywhere, you talk about diabetes, you talk of heart attack. Heart attack takes your life immediately. It can take, a situation can happen like that. But cancer gives one a good amount of time to think about the diagnosis, to think about the treatment, to get a second opinion, and to go about the treatment the way you want. And it is a common understanding between the doctor and the patient and all the relatives. So the cancer definitely gives some time. And there are so many symptoms which we avoid. So we have to go for detection tests, for screening tests, and go for regular checkups so that it does not take our lives. So I'll tell a bit about the cancer cells. It's like the normal cells which grow, multiply 1 into 2, 2 into 4, and so on, so forth. But if one of the cells out of those becomes cancerous, then its nucleus will multiply first. There won't be one nucleus, there can be 2, 3 or multiple nuclei. And because of these nuclei, each nucleus will form a separate cell and it grows fast and it forms the tumor, which becomes, so when the tumor is diagnosed, it's already a couple of years it has been in the body. Yeah. And sometimes the tumor can move from one organ to another organ. It can move through the bloodstream. It can sometimes move through the lymph also. So it moves and this is called metastasis. So it finds a place for itself in some other organ and it starts multiplying over there. So this is known as metastasis. Next. So some of the symptoms which are very important, which we might see them very often in our body, but we neglect them. Like if we have headaches, or if we have vomiting, we have a loose stomach, or sometimes we have blurred vision, blackouts, and all these things people still worry about. But they will think more about their eyes than about cancer. So if we have constant fever, so all these things, these symptoms which have been shown here, if they persist for 2 to 3 months, not only for one day or few days, a week or 10 days, but if it continues, say a prolonged headache is there and it comes back after a few days and then it continues for number of months, then checkups are required. One has to be vigilant. Even a cough. Cough is also a similar thing. It can also be a symptom of breast cancer. And post-coital bleeding, some intermenstrual bleeding, or post-menopausal bleeding. These are also very important for ovarian cancer, cervical cancer. Loss of balance and dizziness, this could be a symptom of brain tumor, etc. So all these symptoms, if they persist, then one has to be vigilant about them. Some of the symptoms for breast cancer. Most common one is having a lump. The lump may be on the breast, inside the breast, or it may be in the armpit. So, so wherever it is, so that's why we said breast self-examination. Once a month, there's a particular way of checking the breast, like moving clockwise on the breast with the palm, press the breast and check it properly and check your underarms as well. And if you feel any change in the size or shape, and you can also look at yourself in the mirror when you're in the bathroom and check both the breasts. Sometimes one breast is bigger than this other one. That doesn't matter. But if there's a change in the size or shape of the breast, that is one of the symptoms. If there's bleeding or discharge from the nipple, that is very maybe a higher stage of the symptoms. And if there's if the nipple bend, it moves inside, or instead of being outside, it goes inside. There's a kind of a bulge inside the breast on the nipple area. So that is also to be taken care of. It has to be checked by the doctor. And there's a redness on the breast, which is called the orange peel scale. It's like an orange, it becomes very red. So that's also one of the very strong symptoms of breast cancer. Yeah, next one. And there are lots of myths when we talk about removing the, if we want people to have an awareness about these non-communicable diseases, we have to debunk the myths. If we remove these myths from the minds of the people about cancer, then half the work is done, half the battle has been won. So some of these I'll talk about here. So one is that if I get cancer, I will die, which is very common. People start crying, they become panicky, and this is not so. So obviously there are so many other people who have been living with cancer for tens of years, decades, and still they are alive and they are living a good life. If my mother had breast cancer, I'll get it too, which is also wrong. If it is genetic, then only a person, next generation can get it. There is a BRCA test which can be done for breast cancer. Cancer is infectious, which is very wrong. People think that the cancer patient should be kept in isolation. And sometimes people will look at the cancer patient and think, oh, she's still alive. I mean, they feel that she should have died long back. There is a restriction of food for a cancer patient, which is wrong. Even during the chemo days, there's no restriction, except that there should be no infection to the cancer patient during the treatment days. But even during chemo days, there is a cycle of 3 weeks. So between the two cycles of chemo, there are 3 weeks. So after the chemo, the WBC goes down. So naturally, first few days, there's nausea and the person feels weak. So it is recommended that the patient stays indoors and does not get any infection from anyone. But then next week, one whole week goes when the patient is completely all right. If he's eating right and he's taking good care of his health, then he's all right. So at that time, he can even move out. He can do anything. He can also go for his job if it's required. We don't need to talk about cancer. This is so prevalent in India and in the developing countries. People are so scared, one, to talk about cancer. And secondly, as I said, that even when we go for giving the cancer awareness presentations, we can see fear on the face of the people. And I first tell everybody that we have not come here to scare you off. We want to remove this fear. That's why we want to talk about cancer. Biopsy spreads cancer to other parts of the body, which is also very wrong. Cancer is formed from the cells inside the body. It is not because of the biopsy. Chemotherapy and radiotherapy reduce immunity, which is very wrong. It is a big myth. And cancer treatment in India is not as good as in Western countries. Nowadays, so many people from other countries come to India and they get the treatment done here. All the treatment done in India is at par with any country in the world. Yeah, next one. Cancer awareness message by Cancer Care India. Cancer Care India is an apex body. Race to Rein in Cancer is also a part of a member of Cancer Care India. There are 46 cancer NGOs under it. So they give this message everywhere that cancer is preventable, it is curable, it is non-contagious. There's life after cancer. Do not get scared of cancer and fight it. Again, early detection saves lives. Yeah, next one. So the take-home message is, most importantly, for those who have not had cancer, they have not been diagnosed, they have to be more particular about their health. They should do more exercises. They should do the breast self-examination. They should also not have tobacco in any form, even not inhale the tobacco fumes. And they should not neglect any of the symptoms which I've talked about here. There may be even more symptoms. So cancer can become a silent killer if it is neglected. Follow a hobby and distract yourself from negative thoughts. This is for everybody, for cancer patients or not non-patients. And if you have cancer, accept it. Like, I have started to accept my cancer and I am living happily with it. Never ever give up. And one thing that I would like to say is that not only follow your hobby, distract yourself from negative thoughts, but do some, I think I have not mentioned here, which was mentioned earlier, that yoga and pranayam, they help a lot. Whether you do art of living, you do anything, any kind of, not more of meditation, but more of pranayam, breathing exercises. Inhale and exhale. When you inhale more of oxygen, the oxygen kills cancer cells. And when you exhale, I think the negativity goes out. You will feel lighter if you do it regularly. And there are so many different exercises which can be followed. Like recently I've started this Chinese exercise, Falun Gong, which is quite interesting. It's quite different. It's interesting. But it soothes you. I think I feel very calm and calm after doing that exercise. It's like more like a dance than an exercise. Yeah, next one. I guess this is all. Yeah. So about Race to Rain in Cancer, as I told you, we registered in 2012. I started this and with my co-worker Rashmi Kapoor, she passed away in June 2013. And she was the founder vice president. But now we have Dr. Nikhil Parvate, who is our vice president. He's a gynecologic surgeon. And he was in Mumbai, but now he's moved to Pune. Next. So RACE is going to hold its first international oncology conference in Delhi, which is on 18th and 19th of November. On 18th of November, we are doing it, the whole day conference with different sessions, three different sessions. So we are going to talk about the cancer at present, is how it is treated, the different types of treatments, about all the different cancers. And then we'll have about the alternative therapy. There'll be doctors from Ayurveda, there'll be doctors talking about different ways of using alternative therapy along with the regular treatment of cancer. And there is also a person, a scientist from Indian Science Congress Association. He's a physics person in Bhubaneswar. He will talk about what he's doing for cancer equipments, for various, I don't know, what some kind of research he's doing for the cancer treatment. And so that's another session. And there will be a panel discussion having two case studies of two different patients. That will be a live, panelists will sit there and they will discuss about two different cases. On 19th, we'll have a visit to the Batra Hospital in Delhi. So that will be a half day program. We go to the hospital, see the wards, see their radiotherapy and other equipment. And then after lunch, it will be over. So this conference is being held along in partnership with three organizations: Media India Center for Research and Development, that's based in Delhi, and Indian Science Congress Association, with the Delhi chapter of it, and Race to Rain in Cancer. This will be in Habitat Center and on 18th. And I welcome everybody, whoever wants to attend, please do come. It's in the Gulmohar Auditorium of India International, India Habitat Center, sorry. Yeah, next one. So, this is a message from Robert Schuller. I really like his books. They are so positive. There will never be another now. I'll make the most of today. There will never be another me. I'll make the most of myself. And I relate this to myself very much. And I try to use every minute, every day as it comes. And enjoy life as it comes. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Rita. Cancer definitely is not infectious, but your smile and your positivity is. It has already infected us. And I hope it infects more people. So some infections are good. Rita, I just wanted to ask, how old were you when you were first diagnosed in 2006?
I was 47 at that time.
Pardon?
47 years old.
Okay. And what was your family's reaction, the first reaction of your family?
My family, actually, as I told you, I was in Assam when I was diagnosed. My husband was out of station, and I went with my friend for the biopsy. And for biopsy, they had to send it to Mumbai. So it took 15 days. And all those 15 days, 10 to 15 days, whatever it took, I was alone, and I was like, you know, you can understand, I was really panicky that whether it will be positive or it should be negative. That's what I thought. But there were other family members over there who were also worried. Everybody was worried. And when I landed at Delhi for my treatment, my mother came to pick me up from the airport. And I thought that she'll smile at me when she sees me. She'll be happy to see me because I'm seeing her after a long time. And there was fear on her face, real fear, and it really struck me so hard. And at that moment I felt, am I really going to die that she's so worried? Now I understand that, since, you know, how it happens, that a mother cannot take her child in such a situation. It's very difficult for her to accept the fact that her husband had cancer, he died of cancer in 1977, and he was 47 years old when he died. And that is also, whether it's a coincidence or not, I don't know, but I was diagnosed at 47. And from the airport, we went straight to the hospital because we knew the doctor whom we had to show. So we went there, and when we showed him, and he, instead of telling me that you come tomorrow and get admitted and all that, he discussed with his team, and he sent me straight to the room upstairs, and he said, go get admitted. And I was going upstairs, and these people at the lift, near the lift, they were telling me, no, you can't go in, the visitors are not allowed inside. Is your mother a patient? I said, no, I'm the patient. And they couldn't understand that this girl can be a patient. I told them that maybe when my hair is lost, then you'll understand, then you'll accept me as a patient. So anyways, I went up to the hospital room, and without anything in my bag, nothing, and then I was admitted to the hospital. And next day, the surgery was done. So I think my family encouraged me a lot, but they were really worried. I could see that.
Did you get chemo and radiation? Both were given to you post-surgery?
Yes. I had modified radical mastectomy, MRM, because the tumor had become 2.5 centimeters at that time. I was even having a pain in my back, spinal somewhere, that side, spinal cord somewhere. So anyway, so after the surgery, I was there in the hospital for 2-3 days, and the doctor told me you have to do exercise of the hand on the left side. So I could not move my hand even a bit. But he said 100 times you have to pull it up and pull it down. And 100 times, 4 times a day, it should be 100 times. So I religiously did whatever he told me. So I tried. Initially, it was not possible. Then, okay. And he said that the surgery is the easiest part of the whole treatment. That time, I didn't believe him. But then when the chemotherapy started, it started after 3 weeks of the surgery. Then I realized how bad chemo can be, and I had 6 chemos of one type and 2 of different type, and every time I used to puke in the hospital. I would enter the hospital and start puking, and all the way back it was bad, and 2-3 days were very bad for me. But the days when I was fine, I used to write. I started emailing and started writing actually at that time, and I even during those days when I felt good, I used to go out. I would visit. I attended weddings. I attended 2 weddings during my chemo days. And after the chemo, whole of radiotherapy was done for 1 month. 32 cycles were given of radiotherapy, all in the Batra hospital. Then I went back to Assam, and every 3 months, I had to come for my checkups for 1 year. And after 1 year, it became 6 months, and then it became yearly. So after 5 years of the treatment, they say that you are cancer-free. But I don't know, after 7 years, again, I got a relapse.
And basically, the second time, you were more of a doctor than the patient, because you were insisting on getting a PET scan done. And what were the symptoms which you felt that time, Rita? Because the doctor was not ready to believe you also.
Oh yeah. Well, when I used to read at night, mostly the pain started at night, and it was all in the chest here. So it used to happen when I was climbing the stairs inside my house. I couldn't climb. It was like an old man is climbing the stairs. It was very difficult for me, because there was a shooting pain. Then at night when I would lie down, I had terrible pain. I could not turn and twist, and it was awful. And this I saw in Google, that the bone cancer pain starts at night. It's mostly at night, and during the day it's perfect. And then our local doctor, whoever, we were working in the university, so the university doctor was called. And he said, ma'am, you do too much of exercises. You do this, you do that. That's why you are fatigued. Then I told him, no, the pain is at night. It's not in the daytime. Early morning at 6 o'clock, I used to go for swimming. 45 minutes, I was perfect. I didn't feel anything in the morning. And I told him this also, that there also I'm lying down, but I don't feel the pain. But it's only at night. Then there was a lot of acidity I had in the, you know, that stomach acidity. So then someone would say that, have ice cream, you'll feel better. And every day I would have 1 or 2 ice creams. And rather I was feeding the cancer rather than removing it. Because milk, sugar and salt, milk and sugar basically, these are cancer feeders. So it increased, and then there was a redness in the chest, and there was a protrusion in that sternum bone. Then that is when the doctor realized something is wrong.
What is the situation now? Now you're going for checkups or regular checkup now? You're still on medication?
I'm taking hormonal treatment. There are 2 different medicines that I have to take every day. This is the allopathic treatment which I'm taking. And they have told me that after 3 months, I have to go for PET scan. If the cancer, there were spots of cancer, 2 different spots. And if these spots do not go away, then you have to go for chemo. And I said that I don't want to go for chemo. So I started this Ayurvedic treatment, which I was taking at Ahmedabad. I have a little faith in that. So I'm taking that.
So you did not have to go for chemo the second time. You did not go in for chemo.
No, I had.
What was that like in 2013?
First there was radiotherapy, there was some confusion amongst the doctors. I was in Ahmedabad, and the doctor there said 5 years are over, so you can stop your medication now. But when I came to Bombay, this doctor had told me to take for 7 years. And he got angry that, why did you stop at 5 years? Because the latest thing is that the latest research is that the medication, hormonal treatment, which people take for after breast cancer, that should go on for 7 years. So one cannot say why it happened and what, but it did. Maybe I'm destined to work for.
Yes, you're destined to work for people and to make them better. But yeah. Now, otherwise, you feel normal, or there is no symptoms or no uneasiness or anything.
No, as such, there's nothing. But I have a little breathing problem nowadays, which is maybe because there's a spot in the lung also.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But yoga helps me a lot.
So that's good, and your positive thinking and your positive attitude, Rita. It was really a pleasure hearing you, and we are very much with you, and we will do whatever we can to help you with this conference which you are organizing, a big thing which you are doing. Count us in, and
I don't know how much my presentation will help others, but if it does, I'll be most happy.
It will, because it is already infected us in this room, so it is going to infect others as well, with a lot of positive attitude and courage. Thank you very much, Rita. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Shola. Thanks.